Okay. Welcome to the planning board meeting for Monday, April 25th, 2016. We're short, let's see, what do we got? Seven of us today. No, we've got six of us today. It's Brian Karp's father had a very serious operation today, and so we're, I'm sure all our thoughts are with Brian and his dad. And obviously, it's better for him to be with his dad tonight as opposed to being with us tonight. I'd like to start by thanking HCAM for videotaping this meeting. That's always very helpful for us. From the agenda standpoint, we're going to have a pretty short one, relatively. Not to say that we won't get out any earlier, but the 9 o'clock Pulte hearing is basically what the few members were at. They really realized that they cannot continue until we get the full board after the election. And particularly Brian, it would have been his second absence, et cetera. So they've asked for us to withdraw the... we'll talk more about that at 9, but so that puts a little bit of a hole in it. So we'll spend probably a lot more time on sidewalks and a few other things that are coming up for the board. So before I open the public hearing for 151 Hayden Row Street, you got six of us. Special permit takes six votes, unanimous. Yes, and your question to you is, do you want to go forward tonight or do you want to go continue to the next meeting so that we can, so you could have one dissenter?
We're prepared to go forward tonight.
Okay. Well, then I will open the public hearing, 151 Hayden Row Street. It's a special permit lot with historic structures. It proposes to create a new lot with a historic structure, which is the house. It does not meet the minimum frontage and area requirements. And why don't you kind of start it and explain what you're trying to do.
Mr. Chairman, board members, my name is Doug Resnick. I represent Phil and Donna Todaro, who are trying to have the house at 151 Hayden Row Street, which is next to Waterfresh Farm, the marketplace, be set aside on its own lot in order to preserve it as a historical structure. And that's what the 210.117.2 allows us to do. So our first stop, of course, naturally, was at the Historical Commission, and we had obtained just a ton of information from the recent part of history, I guess, from Dale and the history of this was originally where Dan and Charlotte Colella, who owned the grocery store, made their homestead with the six girls. They purchased it in the 50s. The store was already open, and Dan went on to plant a variety of fruit and nut trees in the area that's in back of where the marketplace was now. One of the buildings on the property was actually used as a farm stand right out on Hayden Row Street. Let me just throw out the plan here. This is the house that faces Hayden Row in all the pictures. This is the building that was, I'm sorry, this was the farm stand. Dale told me that Shaner sisters, you know, look forward to school starting in the summer because they work basically all day and all night during the summer on the farm. The Colella family farmed other parts of Hayden Row. But more importantly, we thought the house was built around 1880, but apparently Dr. Dr. Yankee brought to the Historical Commission meeting a Mass Historical Commission analysis of the property, and indicated that went back probably further to into the 70s, was first owned by a Mr. Phipps, later owned by a family that lived there until the Colonels bought in the 50s. And in accordance with the definition of historic structures, which is in the definition section of the bylaw and also in the Historical Commission's Chapter 125 in the general bylaws, you know, he's talking about both the association of the property with other, with Hopkinton business as it was developing in the late 1800s along Hayden Row Street. And there was a mix of farmers and people that worked in the shoe factories and so forth. Now, I don't know if that made it into your packets, Mr. Chairman.
I don't think so.
Okay. We have a few extra copies.
Okay. I've got some other ones. Okay.
So, again, to focus in. The resulting lot that you would like to create for the historic structure is basically here. That leaves exactly 5.0 acres for water fresh to maintain its agricultural classification standing, not as 61A. We just think that there's no downside. Well, the reason it got to be this way was when Phil and Donna hooked up with Jeff Barton and decided to make Water Fresh Farm and do the partnership they dreamed of together. It was necessary, when they got around to doing the market, it was necessary to get financing. And the financing was from one lender, and the one lender wanted to have one parcel and so forth. And so it was, all this was subject to the original mortgage. Now, not only do we want to get, I say we, Phil and Donna want to get their house back, but they, it's also 100% okay with the lender to do so. And that's why we're here. There will be, you know, sometimes I know some of these other petitions have involved some kind of quid pro quo, or, you know, if you do this, we'll give you that. There's nothing that's being asked for here. We're just going to keep the house in its present condition.
Ready for questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Why don't I start off with a few questions? 5.00, are you cutting it too close? Somebody's done the math pretty well.
The guys at Waterman Design have, yes.
Okay, so you're comfortable with that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, because, you know.
Yes, sir.
Because
there's a lot riding on that.
There's a lot riding on that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. At one point, I've heard about plans to put a restaurant in the house.
That's no longer
there. Because if you separated the parcels, you couldn't get, there's no way you could, I'm not sure you can classify it under the farm stand anyway. That might be a stretch, but
no.
Yeah,
things have been stretched as they are.
Yeah, that's no longer part of the plan.
Okay, so that's not a plan. Okay. Should the town receive a historic preservation restriction on the house if we are going to grant this on that? And I'm thinking the exterior. That's a question, you know, where we're granting something special. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I don't think that the restrictions have been required in other cases where this has been done. They are, we've reviewed them, and they're extremely cumbersome, and we would prefer if that not be a condition.
Well, if my memory is right, we've only done one other one.
112 is one that I know about.
That's the only one I could find.
112 is Easy Street, right?
But I guess it, but along with all the historic structures in town, and there are lists of them just along Hayden Row Street, no one's asking for a special.
Well, we did one on the Abbott Farm, for sure.
I think that's a little different situation.
Yeah. I don't know.
What do we do on Abbott?
Just like Abbott, the town bought all the backlands with CPC money. And to kind of make the deal go, we allowed the Trust for Public Lands to sell off the farm with a historic deed restriction on the house, exterior at least, and the land right around the house had a agricultural restriction, I believe, on it.
Got it.
So that's kind of what, but the town was in part of it is spending a lot of money to buy surrounding open space, et cetera. I mean, at this point, I think
it doesn't seem like unreasonable.
That's why I'm asking you.
Right, for us, right? Because I mean, if you're going on the premise, it's the historical nature of it. One of the things you want to preserve is the exterior of it. Doesn't that make sense?
We are. It's the exterior has been added on to over the years, but it was determined that as it sits now, it's a historical structure.
Well, I think from a historic structure, we have a vote from the Historic Commission that kind of puts it that, plus there's evidence that I think was presented here, so I don't have a problem finding that it's a historic structure, but, you know, and I'm looking to Claire, because you're on the Historic Commission, don't we like to have...
I have a question. I was not at the president of the meeting when the board voted, but I don't question its findings that based on the background of the house that it is historic, has historic value. My question is more on the application of the bylaw. Is the house in danger? Is it endangered in any way?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Is there any danger of this house if this finding did not, if this was not approved? Do you have plans to demolish the house?
We don't have plans, no. No.
No.
Going forward, I can't.
What I have with this is not from a historic standpoint. The reason I raise issues with it is that when this bylaw was developed by the Historic Commission, it was because there are land development projects that come that the only way for the land to be developed is to take out the home to get at the land in back, and the house is in danger. And so this was developed to save a house where land is going to be developed in such a way that the house would be endangered were it not allowed a special type of a carve-out to carve out a substandard lot so that the house could be saved. And so I don't see that there is, that situation is occurring here. And I'm trying to take emotion and personal issue out of it, because when you look at the application of a bylaw, you try to look at it from a neutral standpoint of, regardless of the circumstance, is this the way the bylaw was, what it was designed to do, or is this somewhat a misuse? I am worried about the slippery slope that this could open up, that simply because this is a home that's 75 years or older, this can be used to carve out a smaller lot that no one else could with their similarly small lot. There's lots of older homes in the town. Does this open it up that then anybody could come and want a small lot carved out to develop or use the rest of their land because they have this historic home that's sort of being used as the golden ticket? I'm worried about a slippery slope because it might be, oh, maybe it'll never happen, but if you apply it to one, then you're beginning to set policy and you're beginning to set precedent, and I'm not sure that that's what this bylaw... I know when it was designed, this was not what the intent was.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, go ahead.
Through the chair. The respect in which the house is in danger is not so much from Phil and Donna, who intend to live there and continue raising their family. They have all girls, too. Continue raising their family there. But if for some reason the entire operation, Waterfresh and the house, were sold together as one parcel, mm-hmm. there'd be absolutely nothing to prevent that person from knocking the house down. And if we go forward and afford this protection, and I don't see anywhere where the bylaw hints at, other than saying it's to preserve historic structures, which I think is exactly what we're doing by this, I don't know where any legislative history makes this more or less needed to do so. So someone, if we didn't do this tonight, okay, and, you know, 15 whatever years from now, Phil decides to sell everything as one piece, then the house is vulnerable. And it's not the danger tomorrow in terms of the demolition permits that, you know, are also subject to a historical commission review. It's the danger in the future.
Well, I would think that, because again, you know, being in harmony with the general purpose of the zoning bylaw, and I still don't believe this was what the bylaw was designed for, but if the way it's written, it fits within it from a legal standpoint, I would hope that right now, the way that's written, there's actually nothing that prevents a property that's received the benefit of this bylaw from later on being demolished.
Mm-hmm.
We have to clean that up, and mm-hmm. we haven't been able to do it for mm-hmm. this year's warrant. Whether you go with a restriction, or I would think if this property is, quote-unquote, bettered by the application of this bylaw, that it should come with some kind of a condition that the home may not be demolished except for the usual case of emergency, destruction by fire, natural causes. There should be something that protects this house if it receives this kind of benefit.
I don't think we have a problem with that.
We don't.
No,
we don't.
Other comments? Yeah, go ahead.
I'm a big fan of Watercrest Farm. The way you're producing agricultural products there is the way to go for the future. I mean, it's you pull together a social and commercial project. It's really, really a good addition to the town. I agree with Ken and Ren and Claire, though, that if we're saying this is a historical farmhouse, then that would cover the external view of the building. But I want to say that you have a lot of land there, but you just don't have the frontage, and I don't see a way around that. If someone other than you lived in a home, they would buy it knowing there's a business there, and they would buy it knowing there's a lot of traffic going to the business and farming going on, so that they'd have to, that's part and parcel of it. But if someone else buys that property, and they would have to maintain it historically, they wouldn't have the frontage for a driveway. And that's, to me, is the core issue that we're looking at. Because when I was on the Conservation Commission, and we were reviewing this, and the Planning Board reviewing this, it's a project as a whole, and including your home and your future business, which is now great and thriving. But I don't see a way around the frontage question, unless you guys can address that.
That seems to be what the bylaw is meant to do. We left 150 feet of frontage for the marketplace. That leaves us with 121.92. And there is going to be some, there are going to be some easements which allow market traffic to go just where it goes right now, and to allow the driveway to the house to be used exactly as it is now. Nothing's going to change. So it's not getting around the frontage requirement, Frank. The reason that the dimensional rules are allowed to be bent is to preserve an historic structure. So I guess what I'm saying to the commission, and having heard us answer this, is that we would be amenable to having a condition or whatever the board wants to craft to make sure that this is preserved as a historical structure, at least the exterior.
I think it brings up an interesting point that I'm trying to search my memory bank for. On the house lot, did we create, when we did site plan review for the farm stand, was any of the parking for the farm stand on what will be now a separate lot?
No.
No. No.
Here's the existing driveway, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, because we had some foul or parking that wasn't going to be built or something in the plan. I just vaguely remember we had some discussions.
It's not on this lot.
Okay.
But so to Frank's point, is the access to this house now going to be over the farm land, or does it have its own? Will it have its own access drive on its own lot? You're saying that there's an easement needs. You're going to depend on going up the lot.
You'll still go in the entrance. It's a one-way U-turn. You still go in the entrance and park over on the lot.
So
in existing parking
so
spaces.
So the house will. In order to access the house, you will have to go over the Waterfresh Farm land. It will not have access of its own.
Well, it could.
It could. I would submit there are many homes on Hayden Real Street that have 90 feet of frontage as we sit here today.
But there's no driveway that's going to go off of your lot.
Well,
you're
it's just the way that the way the drive is configured. Part of the driveway out is on the lot, so theoretically they could sneak in this side and just, but to keep the traffic flow safe, Claire.
I understand that, but you know, you're claiming to create a lot that will be separate from the operation. So
yes.
It's a logical question to then ask, if further down the road those are owned by different people, is this house going to be able to have access without the benefit of the next door neighbor? Who
easements have to accompany that, and they're referenced in this plan.
Just, can you show where the driveway is on and the where the lot line is?
Sure.
It may pay to... Sorry, anybody can see it.
That's okay. This dark line is the lot.
Okay.
The exit driveway is here and here.
Okay.
It's down here.
So where the driveway...
You could get access.
Where the driveway hits Hayden Row, almost at...
entire width is on the house property. Okay.
So you're saying that Waterfresh Farms driveway will be on the house's property?
Yes. Part of it. A little part of it.
The house is going to have to give an easement to Waterfresh Farms.
Exactly.
That's correct.
Both ways.
Why don't I suggest this, and I don't know where we are. We're starting to get a little bit behind, but we've got time to make it up today. I think we're to the point where if we're going to craft some historic preservation language, it's best not to be done tonight, but be done elsewhere. And I'd also like people to look at the site plan review to make sure we didn't do something that would screw this thing up. And I apologize, I didn't think about that question until basically Frank kind of asked it. So, yeah.
Mr. Chairman, would that require us to request a withdrawal of the application?
No. We'll hear it at our next meeting.
When is your next meeting?
May 9th.
It's
May 9th.
We didn't give you that A&R plan back.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We didn't clock it in yet.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. He handed us an A&R plan, so before the clock starts, we'll give it back to him.
Gotcha.
Okay. Just to make sure. The A&R has been filed. It said in our note, an A&R had not been filed.
Right. He brought it tonight to start the clock, but before the clock starts, because we didn't stamp it in yet, we'll give it right back to him.
Yeah, and just to be clear, all the parking that was approved is inside of this dotted line over here. There's parking to the house over here.
Yep.
But for the business, it's the drive is here and the parking is inside of that line.
Okay.
Okay? On both sides.
Okay.
I know one time we talked about some parking on this side of the road as well from the property line, but we never constructed that.
Yep.
Okay. And then we also expanded. I think the expansion you're thinking about, Ken, is this was graveled. This was kept undeveloped.
Mm-hmm.
The future expansion of parking is right here on both sides.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm just not well to remember details. I'm sorry.
No, it's been 4 years. I wouldn't expect you to.
It should have kept a little bit more land when you sold it to the town in the back. You almost created yourself a hardship. But sounds like you're going to squeak it in, I guess.
So May 9th, we have Ash Street, 25 Ash at 7:30.
Let's do it at 8 with the possibility that they might go a little bit longer. We'll make sure we have enough time to handle both, but I just don't want to be sitting for a while if Ash, that one could go really fast or really slow, depending on what's going on with that one.
Okay.
So, look for a motion to continue this public hearing until 8 o'clock on May 9th.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone oppose? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Have a good night.
Joanne, you're up next.
Don't leave yet. She's got your check and you're happy.
Oh,
okay. Bring it with you next time.
Thank you. Thanks, sir.
You're welcome. Sure. Good evening. Yes, likewise.
Okay. I think you've got some samples for us today, is what I've heard.
I do, so good evening.
Introduce
so
yourself. You've been here before.
Yes,
Joanne Boyce.
Joanne Boyce, project manager, EverSource.
Sure.
So I just want to re-familiarize
the board with the area that we're talking about. So the samples that we're talking about are for this area right here, which is supposed to cover the new equipment at the front of the station on South Street. So I just wanted to kind of give a visual.
I think everybody, this is our South Street station, electrical station. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I think everyone's familiar with it.
Yep. Yep. So these are, so right now we have pretty much three samples, three different colors, color choices. Put that one here and this one here. So we know that over the course of the discussions, you know, the visual impact of this project has been a source of much discussion with the board. So we saw it fit to bring it before you and, you know, get your input as far as the samples that you would like to see for the wall, proposed wall at the front.
What is the wall made out of?
It's a it's basically wood shavings that are chemically bonded with cement. Okay. I have the literature on that if you're interested.
This is all going to be stone, correct?
Yes, this will be that material. Currently, the existing finishes matches closer to this one right here, this sample right here. But you know, we decided to bring a couple of additional options.
Well, Claire, you are aesthetic from Design Review Board.
I thought Jeff was going to be here, but
yeah. I know, I watched the tape, you said someone other than the
player. Here I am.
I'm not allowed to pick out colors in my house, so.
Maybe we should slide this down.
So those are all sound-absorbing things, and you said the one on the right is pretty similar to the color that's already there?
Correct.
So how close is it? I mean, if you pick that one,
yep,
is it going to match it, or is it going to be just off enough that it's going to look really weird?
No, it's going to match.
Exact match.
It's going to match it. Well, because from my understanding, it's the same manufacturer, so we'll have them come out and match.
It's kind of close, but not quite. It looks worse than just trying to do something.
Sure, I understand.
Completely different. Do you know how they hold up to the sun and discoloration? Would that darker one be liable to fade, or weather would just be safer with the lighter color that isn't going to fade out in the sun and look worn?
From the literature that I've read and from, you know, stuff that's on there, it seems to hold out very well in in the sunlight.
Is this the material that's on there now?
This is similar material. Okay.
And how long does that last for? What's the lifespan of it?
I don't know the exact lifespan. It's in excess of 30 years. So
you don't paint that very often?
No, because it's anti mold resistant.
Oh, okay.
It's not subject to the elements.
I'm going to stay out of it because I'm not allowed to pick colors. So
can I just ask, where on that building that you show there are the existing panels that are that light color, and where would the new ones go?
So the existing building is this.
The top van.
This top van right here. And if you
hold it up there at the top, yeah.
So the existing building is this built, this big structure back
there. The whole building is there.
The whole thing is already that color.
Right, and then we have this small section here that's added.
I see. Oh, so it's going to be, there's a separation between them.
Correct.
And it still gets a fence where they connect?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely.
So it's just a front wall to the same building.
Well, I mean, my feeling would be that it makes sense to go with what you've already got. If there's enough of a separation between them that, you know, the... not going to show if there's a slight variation, unless it's way off.
And I believe you guys committed to these plantings up in front of it.
That's correct.
Which hopefully is, that's the biggest thing that we're more excited about the plantings than the walls.
Sure.
But.
I don't know. You think it's stupid what they got?
I think so. That makes the most sense, yeah.
Okay.
Sounds like you got a consensus on your color.
Yeah, okay. I agree. Whatever you do, don't put that top one with that one.
No, it's...
Yeah.
Oh.
Sure.
Yeah, I'd say if you can't get a good match, then you'd be better to go with the dark
right
in the front so that there's a clear contrast rather than kind of sort of, but not quite.
Yep, sure. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. You got a minute? You can take on another little matter today?
I hope so.
These are pictures from Mr. McDowell, Legacy Farms. The first one is the pole that's now in the middle of 85. And Verizon has set months and months and months and months ago.
Okay.
The pole that you barely see off the picture. In fact, you can see it on the second picture.
I see it, yeah.
And nobody can get from Eversource, as of yesterday, when this pole is going to get moved. Or your wires. That's all we care about at this point. You're next up. And quite frankly, the guy that takes all the work orders, from what I hear from Mr. McDowell, he acknowledges he has a work order, but he won't give him any answer at all as to when he wants to schedule it. And we're trying to pave and put a lane that's going to go right through that pole. We're obviously more than a little bit concerned about this pole, as you can see how it's been flagged. But it's really frustrating that we can't even get an answer as to when it might be done.
Understood. If I could get back to you before Friday of this week, but hopefully tomorrow.
Okay.
I hope to get an answer on the proposed date of when we'll transfer.
Okay. Then that's the first poll.
Okay.
Then the next three pictures, the last three pictures in there, are pictures of the pole that's in the middle of Franklin Road, which is Legacy North. Now, that one, I think you got paid for the work order for that sometime in August.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe it is now almost the end of April.
Good news on that one.
That one, yeah?
Yeah, good news on that one. I took similar pictures. And, Dwayne, you want to give the update?
Sure. So there was a response from the manager of the South Door area, which is responsible for this area, saying that that'll be scheduled to be transferred this week. If not, he reached out to the supervisor to make it a priority to have it installed by the end of next week.
I think it's weather permitting, to be honest, with this week.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's
so
good news.
I'll follow up with both of those.
Now, the sad part about it is you can see these pictures, but the next three poles down the line have got white arrows pointed to them because they have to get higher because you're upgrading the service to Legacy Farms Road North. You know, that goes underground through that whole process. Unfortunately, on those three poles, Verizon hasn't set the replacement pole, which, and I think they're still on strike, I think. So that one kind of is holding up the works.
Unfortunately, unless something was imminent danger, we're going to basically wait till Verizon workers come back, unless Verizon current crew or management, whoever is setting poles, can do something. So
yeah.
We can put a request in. I just don't believe that will take a priority, but I can't really speak on Verizon or Verizon.
Yeah. Well, if you can get this one that's out of the wires transferred out of the line, I mean, that'll at least get the first one. Then Verizon can maybe, whenever they get their wires out, but obviously right now they're pointing the finger at you guys.
Okay.
Now, we have been really frustrated, and this isn't the first time I think you've heard it from the board, about the inability of both utilities to move poles out of the right-of-way. In the School Street, West Main Street intersection took the better part of a year, I think, to move the poles. It cost the town a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
This is, you know, the town is, and with the developer's support, is doing Legacy Farms Road North. And, you know, it's costing us money just, you know, to put stuff in there, and the amount of time and energy Mr. McDowell has spent, and even this board, in just hearing about it, is just very frustrating. I talked to Representative Dykema about potentially filing legislation next year that puts a time limit on the utilities for transferring poles. And when I first brought up the pole issue with Representative Dykema, she says, "Are you worried about double poles?" I says, "Double poles, I can live with double poles. I mean, I don't like to look at double poles, But I'm just worried about getting the new ones in so that we can serve customers. And, you know, it's, I mean, it took the better part of 6 months to get the conduit fed on Legacy South. They, you know, they were doing all the apartment complex building. They had them all drywall and painted with generators on each one. I just don't understand that business philosophy of where you're not worried about new customers. I know you're a monopoly, but you got to do some customer service.
I think we're in a disadvantage because sometimes and many times there's a story behind, you know, just a certain poll in the sense that, you know, this one seems to be pretty clear. It's just one transfer. When you look at Franklin and you see, you know, the number of polls and then other poll setting, I'm going to, you know, guess that most of the decision could be, and this isn't for, you know, definite, but it could be that, you know, they wanted just to get the crews, because this is probably at least two crew to do the number of work, two trucks, and, you know, working side by side, maybe even three or four, but should just to keep them kind of going from pole to pole, you know, so basically you're doing the job once, you're getting the police details, you're getting all of the crews, you know, designated for one spot to do the necessary work. Now, and then sometimes...
I've been by all that. I'm project manager by training.
Yeah,
that's how I'd organize the thing. Mm-hmm. But I wouldn't make my customer wait 8 months.
Well, you know, sometimes when the request comes in, you know, Verizon will, you know, start the work, and, you know, maybe we have other work to be done, and so we're not ready to really go in. I mean, you know, I know the West Main Street School, there were some situations that it was a communication, there was work on equipment that had to be done before we could just do a simple transfer. And, you know, sometimes, I mean, you know, in these cases here, well, sometimes they're not simple transfers when you have a pole that is with the wires going up the side. They call it a standpipe, and it requires underground crews as well as overhead. So it's really just getting the crew availability. But with that said, I certainly think you've been waiting for these, and it's understood, and we've communicated that.
And last winter, we waited for just down the road there at Legacy Farms and East Main Street with the pole right in the middle of there, and there was two poles that had to be lengthened so that we could, Mr. McDowell could do the road work on that. I mean, it's...
What's the average length, Mr. Chairman, what's the average length of wait time for a work order like this to go through? Is this typical? Are we typical, or is this atypical? Because 8 months or whatever...
Oh, it's typical from what I'm hearing out of the communities. I think it was Representative Dykema said it was subject to some legislative hearings on that. There's supposed to be a report. I haven't followed up with her this week to get that report, but I will.
What we do in many communities, and certainly, you know, are working better towards it, is the pre-construction. So when you have roadway, a road widening project or whatever it might be that would require it, you know, many times we're at meetings, but Verizon's not there, and of course Verizon is responsible to set the poles. And so we're, you know, working to getting all the right folks in. On it, you know, at a pre-construction, and we've seen many communities, and it's been very favorable. So we get a 3-year plan, maybe even a 5-year plan, and we're working with the gas and the electric folks to coordinate the projects, and the towns are maybe tweaking what they need, and we're tweaking what we need so that this situation isn't happening. And you know, so we just, there's a gas pre-construction meeting tomorrow. And on the electric side, we don't have anything major planned, but it's these kind of things that require our attention just to get the other parties to move on their wires as well. So we'll take these back, and I certainly understand, and it's been heard and shared internally, but, you know, I don't blame you for bringing that up.
Okay. Well, we look forward to your new best friend, Jennifer, here will be happy to take the answer and distribute it to the rest of us on that. And, you know, a lot of this is work our developer's doing, but we, you know, this fall we had a couple where, you know, guy couldn't, you know, couldn't get his underground wires to the building over on Lumber Street. You know, it was delayed, and you know, it's just, you know,
frustrating.
It's very frustrating. Yeah, it's a good word. Okay.
Thank you. Oh, comment, or I guess maybe more of a question. For our television audience, you covered it a little bit, but can you describe who owns the poles and the process? Like, are you saying Verizon owns the poles, and then they manage where they go and when they go, and then you work with them, and cable company works with them? And,
who
drives it?
There's an agreement. So many of the poles will be jointly owned. And there's an agreement that Verizon will set the poles here in the town of Hopkinton. And when the pole is stripped of all the wires and equipment and guy wires, they would return and remove the old pole. And so when the town is starting a project, it's key that not just Eversource is in the room to hear about the project, but Verizon, because Verizon is going to start the work order. And so once the work order is established, there's a communication piece that comes over to Eversource. And this would be, you know, for all projects. And once we get that piece of information, there has to be a sign-off or something on that nature, and then the work order will begin. Once the pole is set, our goal is to do the wire transfers in a reasonable fashion. And, you know, again, sometimes I will say there's stories that I'm not privy to of the field conditions, and I think that might be the case with Legacy Farms, but I don't have confirmation of that. But if I had the right appropriate folks here today, they might explain some of these situations. But this length of time, it does seem to be extensive.
And a follow-up question to the project manager.
Oh, go ahead.
You mentioned you spoke to the manager of the Southboro area of Eversource or of Verizon?
Eversource.
And then he said that this should be resolved within
next week.
And then possibly with Verizon being on strike, it could be an issue.
Well, I think those poles are already set.
The poles are set.
The poles that are set.
But no, they'll transfer the wires, and then they top the pole. Then it's Verizon, who's probably next on the pole. They'll have to do their work, and then usually the cable guy, and then it goes back to Verizon to pull off the pole.
But I think what was shared is that on the Franklin Street, there are some additional poles that need to be set, and those would be set by Verizon, so we'd wait for Verizon to set those poles.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much for coming
in.
Okay.
Thank you.
Welcome aboard, Jennifer.
Yeah, you can have this for the record. Okay, hopefully we're ready for DPW garage.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Hello.
Hey, John.
Copy for Jennifer.
Is Danny coming in?
Yes, he is.
Oh, okay.
It's all gone.
Let's see. Where are we on voting numbers today for this one?
Billy Irwin, who's here to vote, because John signed me.
Okay.
He watched the meeting and signed, so I believe we're all set.
Okay. And we only need 5 votes for a site plan review, and we have 7 members.
6.
6. 6. So.
You can
make one of us mad. Hopefully not.
It's our hope, Mr. Chairman, that we're going to address everyone's concerns.
I understand. And then, after we get done with this, we've canceled out the Pulte folks tonight. So you've got to a reasonable time, but we want to talk about sidewalks after this.
So excellent.
Maximize your availability, John.
Beautiful. Thank you. The Eversource folks might have grabbed Dan.
Oh, really?
So, Chairman, you say you're canceling the Legacy Farms continuance?
Yes. We basically run out of voting members until after the election, so we'll kind of restart the legacy process.
All right.
And understood. The goal is to do it in a expedited, abbreviated, is until the new members get comfortable with where we're at. I was also not too pleased with them today at submitting revised plans today and to discuss it tonight. I mean, that, you know, that is not courteous to the board. But it's primarily we're about to run out of members. So we'll deal with that. We'll need about, you know, let's hope we get through this tonight. That's what my goal is.
Mr. Chairman, yeah. The chairman of the PBC, Dan McIntyre, is double booked. He's at a meeting with the Conservation Commission.
Okay.
He'll be in here in about 10 minutes, but we're certainly
ready
with our engineers and architects.
Okay, great. Okay, so let's open the continued public hearing for 83 Wood Street, site plan review, Town of Hopkinton, new DPW facility. So, hearing is open. Why don't you start off with talking about the plan changes from the last time? There might have been a few minor changes, for sure a sidewalk and whatever else kind of got updated in the plans between now and the last meeting.
Okay. And I know it's going to be difficult for some of the back to see, but I'll just generally discuss. As we talked about in the last meeting, one of the main focuses was trying to get sidewalks on Wood Street. Mm-hmm. And so what we have shown in the plans that were submitted in your package is sidewalks beginning at this entry point here, running this length as requested, and also extending to this limit of the property as requested. So we were able to get those input into the plan, make everything work. We actually met with Design Review Board and also explained that to them, and ultimately received their approval through that process.
Okay. And any other significant changes to the plan?
Significant changes? No, there was several clarifications that were requested in the independent review.
Mm-hmm.
Much of that had to do with detailing and confirming capacities of roof drain, and all of those were incorporated into the detail sheets. I can go through those.
I think if the engineers are happy, let's kind of leave those alone, if everyone is all set with that. Okay, so I think we're back to going through the outline and just basically trying to make sure we've got everything covered, and then we'll go through design review comments and a few things like that, and then we'll see where we're at. Okay, I think we left off on stormwater management, and I believe, given with Beta's letter, you guys are happy with stormwater.
We made a few comments at the last go-round, and they've sufficiently addressed everything we had requested. So,
any comments or questions on stormwater from members of the board? Or anyone from the public, which I don't.
I'm a hybrid.
Yeah. Okay. Is everyone consensus that they've met stormwater, particularly because they're under conservation, restrictions also, too? So, okay. Parking lot design. I think when we last left that, we determined that it had enough spots. I think that was somewhere I've read. And so we have enough spots. Everything has been able to turn and get in and out of it. Other questions from members of the board on parking lot design?
I suppose I appreciate the changes that have been made. Looks good.
Thank you.
question. Can you just refresh me? Did you have any excess spaces in the number or just enough?
I believe it was one extra space.
Oh, okay. Yep. One. Okay.
How many spaces total?
If I recall, I think it's 39. It was designed, and the design standard was 38. What was it, 39 or 40?
It's going to have more than the occupancy, but based on the design standard, it shows one.
It's going to have more than you intend.
One more.
Yeah, correct.
That's what I was going to get to, Mr. Chairman. At maximum capacity of the workforce, uh-huh. it will be less than 30 employees.
Okay.
So there's ample room there for the public that comes in for permitting and questions.
So how many employees do you think usually are parking there?
It will be around 27, 28.
Okay.
Most guys drive their own truck.
No, they do.
Yeah.
But we don't typically have all 28 there at once with vacation time and sick time and personal time.
Mm-hmm. The reason I ask is, I'm going to keep going back to this, I'm still harping on that salt sand thing and trying to find a place, and I was just wondering if these four spaces over here to the side, except they're right in front of where the trucks come out, is a kind of a area that you might put a bin or something instead of all the parking and have some way that people could anyway, I'm just trying to think creatively where you can put that on this site, because the whole salt issue, the ashes could probably go down at Fruit Street or something, but the salt issue, even if you did Irving to Darrow, I think there may be some wetlands down there, but they might worry about the salt.
Through the chairman, for the benefit of the rest of the members of the planning board, when we were at the design review board, we talked about the salt and sand pile. Where we have it now, it's very dangerous during our winter operations. We've had many near misses where we're backing out with a loader, limited visibility, and cars are just coming in nonchalantly, not aware of all the activities that are there. And here, we've got all of that concentrated onto the site. We really prefer not to have the public coming in there. Plus, at night, it's going to be gated. So there's really no access for folks after hours. We are committed to continuing providing that to the residents. Just not sure that this is the location where we'll end up.
A comment about that. We did talk about this last time here, too. I think this is an improvement over the way it is now, and my only concern was the gatedness of it, and I was thinking maybe if you put like an extra big barrel out with sand for when it is after hours for emergency use, because there have been times where we needed it, you know, and let's go get some sand quick and come back, and you know, someone's stuck, and then it's kind of an important thing.
It's definitely important, and I know it's something that the residents have come to expect and to need. So we're committed to providing that, but this may not be the site for it. We're looking at our options perhaps over on Fruit Street, outside of the impacts to drinking water wells.
Mm-hmm.
I know that the committee that is looking at the Irvine Todaro property is looking at perhaps setting aside some land for DPW use.
Be several locations.
Yeah. So we're looking at our options. Again, here I don't see that this is going to be the best place for the public to be accessing during storms.
Mr. Chairman, I don't want that to be forgotten, because it is something that's important to the residents.
Absolutely.
Is it possible to condition that where it's not relative to this particular site that it be provided, or that would be off-site, so maybe you can't put it on this? I just want to make sure that doesn't get swept aside.
Well, hopefully some future selectman will keep her. her stuff
gets forgotten.
I want to reiterate that again, and maybe state this in a better manner. One of the main reasons I ever go to this location is to get sand or salt in an emergency, which I've done, and a lot of my neighbors have. And when I was growing up in the 70s, we'd have the buckets out, the yellow post around them, and then DPW would go around, fill them up every weekend in case there was a storm. That's pretty expensive, but getting to a location like this makes more sense. It's easy for DPW to handle, because you're kind of taking away access to something we have right now, and you're getting a great new building, and it's like it's easy to put up a couple buckets of sand out, and just in case of an emergency here and in other locations around town, that's a critical need for people that maybe don't pay much attention to what's going on in the town, and you know, this is our tax money. We'd like to have some of that still available to us.
And again, Mr. Chairman, I don't want us to get caught on the fact of the DPW providing sand and salt. We're committed to continue to provide that. If we can put it here somewhere out in the front safely, where it's not going to be an impact, we will absolutely look at that.
Thank you.
As well as other locations across town. Mind you, now, in the 70s, it was different. You could put out a couple of barrels. Now, the pile goes during a storm. Mm-hmm. People pull up with their pickup truck. They load that. And so it is a need, and we're committed to continuing to provide
this. Will save the town money from people doing that.
Okay. Let's, we've actually, I think we've got a consensus, and we're done with parking lot and... go ahead.
Dave Paul says Meadowland Drive. Just a question about the, John, you mentioned visitor parking. Will that be labeled with signage? Or?
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, yes, that will be labeled.
Thank you.
And primarily, it's just people coming in for permits. You don't have meeting space that you would normally have.
I think that the training, the kitchen slash break room slash training room is expected to be used as a public meeting space.
Okay.
But not during normal hours.
Got it.
So that entire parking lot, and it's, how many spaces?
42.
42 spaces will be available.
So we could have a planning board meeting there if we so scheduled it?
Love to have you. We have to get through this process first.
We already got dibs on the library meeting. Okay. Let's see. I think we're into lighting. I think there was a lighting plan here, and I think you were in reasonable amount of lighting, and we also put together a condition that with lighting that says you turn it off, I think is the condition, except for when there's a storm or an emergency.
And the, by 7 p.m., I think it was.
I think it was 1 hour after you closed the facility, if I remember.
Oh, yeah, 1 hour. Following close of building to the public, and no case shall be on after 11 p.m. except in the case of an emergency or storm event.
Which I think is pretty bright, the right type of exemption.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So, parking lot, what's kind of the bright spots?
And so, this just gives you a sense of where the lighting is. And what we've provided is lighting into the site for the parking area, and then also around the perimeter, where you have the main yard operations with pole lights, Dave, would be 15 feet?
Yes.
15-foot pole?
Yep.
Building-mounted lights around portions of the perimeter at 12 feet per the requirements of the town. No spillage off of the site.
Questions about lighting anymore?
Under the canopies?
Yeah, we also have, we do have entry canopies into the building at three locations. Those will have smaller undermounted lights.
Sure, where the doors,
Emergency power, yeah.
Sure.
And how does that compare with what is there today in terms of illumination?
I think it's primarily wall-mounted lights that...
blast everywhere.
Yeah,
correct.
Blast everywhere. Mm-hmm. These are all cut-off fixtures, house shields on the front portion, so you don't have direct view into the fixtures.
Just comment from the designer view, you are going to use those diffusers over the wall packs that we talked about?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
And just for the board, I know there is a prohibition against uplighting, but we did ask for a very small amount of lighting underneath the DPW sign at the overhang.
Right.
But I notice it says that we can, it may be allowed by special permit, so I guess we'll allow that.
Well, that's really considered uplighting.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's agree that that's not what we were talking about.
Yeah. Just confirming you're going to do that. That those diffusers.
Okay. Do we have a consensus about everyone that we should go on beyond lighting? I guess I see no reason why we keep talking about that. Let's check that off. How about building and screening? I think that might have been more design review type comments, but go
on
ahead.
So what are we on now? I'm sorry.
Building and screening.
Oh, building and screening. So, yes, we've gone through the design review board, and we've provided a landscaping plan to improve the overall aesthetics on the front of the building. And one of the items that we had originally in the plan is a fence around the generator enclosure area, and at the recommendation of the design review board, we're going to be changing that out to just plantings, so you don't have basically an ugly fence in the front of the building. So that was one of the conditions, recommendations from the design review board.
Okay, what do the plans show tonight? Fence or
the fence? Correct.
Okay, so we'll figure out a condition for that one.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, I think that the design review board's recommendation of plantings is also going to help us with site distance, because right beside where that generator is the main exit point of the garage. And if you've got that big trucks coming out and the public merging at that point right there, we wouldn't want a stockade fence that would block that view, so that the plantings will provide better safety and visibility.
Where does the generator move to?
Well, the generator stays there. It's just that it's no longer going to have a fence around it. It's going to have plantings.
And natural screening.
This is a separate generator than from the generators in front of the pump station.
Correct.
Okay. Unfortunately, you couldn't size one to do both, huh?
The engineers are going to look at whether or not there is any capacity within that generator to help downsize. But no, we
okay. Didn't. Claire?
Not to be a fly nut in here, but I know after design review, it mentions that there's the required 50-foot vegetated buffer along the westerly side should be waived because it's a dense wooded area. And then I went by there the other day, and that house directly to the west, it's all deciduous and vines. And at this time of the year, now, granted, what they're going to be seeing now is a huge improvement over what's there now. And you're not going to have much activity going on that side of the building. There's no lighting. But it doesn't have the kind of screening I thought it did. It's really not dense wooded at all. You can see straight through. The only problem is I looked in that along the property line, there's sort of like a gully with a little creek or something running through there. So I don't know. I mean, I'd really like to see some amount of evergreen screening for those neighbors, because you can see right through, but I'm not sure where you put it.
I think we talked about that, and you'd be going into the wetlands to try to plant them, which is not
a mucky little swamp thing.
Yeah, the butters were here for the last meeting. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I believe they indicated one of the benefits in our discussion with them was that right now, they see right into the yard, and what you'll have here is that you'll be shielding all the yard operations.
Right.
Yeah.
So, in trying to plant in that area, in that wetland area, it's not viable. Would be more of an issue with conservation, because we'd have to disturb that area.
Yeah.
So, I think the building really is intended, and that was the purpose of this layout, to shield that operation that they currently see. Right. They won't see it, nor will they hear it.
Okay.
But we should probably keep something in place in case it doesn't turn out as the way you expect it. And then if there's an issue going forward, at least have the availability of some money to some plantings down the
building. I don't think you could get in there after the building's built. Well, maybe do it by hand.
Well, yeah, that's what I was assuming.
I mean,
don't put your tractor in back there.
You know, I just think that's hard. And then you also got CONCOM. I mean, that's all subject to CONCOM. You're not going to be allowed to plant anything in there, I don't think.
Yeah,
I guess the only option would be if you wanted to plant something on the neighbor's land. If they wanted it, they wanted a few arborvitae or something put in on their property to shield it, but they seem to be okay.
They didn't say anything at the last meeting.
Right.
How high is the building going to be on that site again? Did we talk about that?
We talked about
23 them. Feet to the eave.
Yeah. Here's the trade-off, because you don't really hear it then. You don't hear it, but you're looking at a big wall
that's
23 feet tall.
Yeah, and when in the elevations we showed how we're going to break up that massing, and then we'll be back to the design review board when we get shop drawings into select colors. So they can be, the abutters can be notified at that time as well.
Make it pretty like the Mass Highway building's going to be.
It's about a facade.
I'm just kidding. Okay. We done with building and screening? Okay. Utilities, I believe everything's underground. And you know who to apply for water and sewer permits. David?
Hi, Dave Paul. Just a question. I noticed that the wires coming across today across the street, there's like three or four different sets of them, different poles. Is that going to be like be able to consolidate at all? Or?
Yeah, we are consolidating. We're bringing it across underground.
Oh, excellent.
Yep, so we don't have the wires across the street.
Excellent. Thank you.
The one going for the sewer pump station stays on that brand new pole?
Correct. But that's on the northwesterly corner.
Where did that pole end up, John?
Where did which pole?
The one by the pump station.
They basically put a new one right beside the existing one.
Which is kind of show us where on the plan, kind of. It's kind of right, kind of behind the building, or right in the front there.
Yeah.
Okay. Did that all get done?
Yes.
Finally.
Finally. About a week ago.
Really? Oh, I would have added that to Mrs. O'Leary's. But we already had enough to talk about with her. Okay, any other questions on utilities? Construction management plan. I didn't see one. I'm not sure we need one per se for this, particularly because it's a town-owned position or plant. What is your plant? You're going to move everything off-site?
Correct.
To Fruit Street?
Correct. I've already met with Elaine Lazarus and Chuck Cadlick. There are no special permits required for that. The only thing required is for permits for the temporary trailers that we're moving in for the office space and for the men for their lunch and break rooms.
Are you moving? You're moving your temporary buildings over there too? Your shelters or not?
Interestingly enough, Mr. Chairman, it costs more to move those than it does to buy new. So we are looking at our options as far as those buildings.
I have a hard time believing. Even all the cement pile, you got a lot of cement stuff too.
We push back. It costs literally more to take those down and reassemble them at a different location than to buy a new one, two new ones, and put them over there.
But you still got to take these down.
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. So we're looking at our options. We're going to need sand and salt storage. Mm-hmm. So we're likely going to put that out through the procurement process to find land to lease. We may use those temporary buildings, those I'll call them tents, for sand and salt storage at that location.
Yeah, you're not going to do sand and salt at Fruit Street, I would hope.
No.
I'd hope not, let me put it that way.
Well, if there's a quarry area.
No, you cannot. There was a problem in the 90s when Pine was doing that, and quite frankly, the well was contaminated for about 10 years until the water flushed it out, and it's now north of that.
That's why we understand that we have to go through the procurement process to lease land.
Yeah, okay. Or the Todaro Irvine property.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. What's the construction period for the school? Will they have their access road in
before
winter?
I don't know. If not, an access road might be a small part of it. You know,
that's an excellent point.
Anyway, I'm just, whatever.
No, that's an excellent point.
Might save you a buck or two.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anything other questions, construction manager? Okay. Emergency generator, we were talking about both your screening on yours and the screening on the one for the DPW, or the sewer pump station. Mm-hmm. Does that have some screening trees around that or something, or is that in our other condition?
When we came in for the sewer pump station, there was a site plan special permit that was issued at that time, and it did require screening in front of that larger generator for the pump station, so we're committed to putting up screening in front of that. And as you heard earlier, the generator for this building will have plantings at the request of the designer.
And we make it clear that approval of this plan does not relieve of that requirement.
Understood.
Okay. Anyone else ready about screening? Hey, Dad, come sit down. No, we're just about ready to get this thing done tonight, so don't say much.
I won't.
We already negotiated a shared parking agreement.
Beautiful. We're all set.
We're holding our meetings there.
Let's see. Solar panels. I think that was Frank's issue, and I thought we kind of had an answer at one point, but why don't we repeat it, because I forgot.
Yep, so with this facility, what we do is we build in the additional loading so that at any time in the future, the building can be equipped with solar panels. It's a standing seam metal roof, so they just clip right to the metal roof. So the building is set up, so at any time that becomes a cost-effective alternative, the town can install that.
And do we have quotes and stuff like that lined up for any solar panels, or?
No, that wasn't anticipated as part of this construction project. But if grants come available for adding solar panels that will reduce our long-term electrical costs, we'll certainly look at that.
All right. So, I'm going to say a little bit about that. You know, our electrical bills for townwide, we pay like $1 million a year, something close to that. And the solar panels we have on the police, fire, and schools perform pretty well. We don't own those, we lease them, and we get the benefit of having power generated. When town meeting approved the plan for a solar project field on Fruit Street, that plan was, couldn't happen with Eversource infrastructure issues, but the sizing of it was designed to alleviate most electrical power that the town needs. So we could generate on, 8 acres, $1 million worth of electricity a year. The roof of a brand new building in 2016 should be designed in mind for solar panels, and we should be putting solar panels up that we own to get the most benefit. I own my solar panels, and I save about at least a third of my electricity in the winter, and two-thirds in the summer. I think that this building is replacing an older building that's not meeting our needs. And if we're going to build a new building, we should build it with an eye to the future and incorporate solar panels now at the beginning stage where it's the least expensive. It's just the cost of the panels and the installation of them and everything else is free money. The sun shines on this building with 23 feet in the air, hardly any trees around it that will block the sun, and it will go a long way to help alleviate the power that you're using, because you'll be using a lot more power in this building. It's doing a lot more things than the previous building has, and it's just the most cost-efficient way to move forward, even though it's more of an outlay at the beginning. But it's cheaper to do at the beginning stages of construction than it is to retrofit something after the fact, even though you guys planned ahead for it. But now's the time to do it for the greatest benefit. And that's my suggestion. And I'd like to see you guys get quotes for something at least, because that's the responsible thing to do in this day and age. And I'd like to ask that you guys do that.
through Mr. Chairman. I totally agree with everything that you've said. We have, when we put together the cost estimate that we went to town meeting for and we received approval for, didn't include solar panels. We can certainly look at what the solar panels would cost and have that cost available. But I suspect that that's going to bust our budget on the building itself. That's why I suggested that we would look at if there are any loans or grants
out there. Which is always good. Mm-hmm. But I'm asking this in light of the library project needs parking that we might need for overflow parking four times a year. We're paying $16,000 a month. Mm-hmm. And where's
no,
that money?
No, we're not. We're at $16,000
a year. $16,000 a year. Solar panels are roughly $1,000 per panel to buy and have installed. Round number. Cost less in bulk, but if we're getting, say, 40 solar panels on the roof of this building, it's $40,000 that will save $40,000 within 4 or 5 years, and they'll pay for themselves. It's a multi-million dollar project, and I'd like to, I think $40,000 or $20,000 would be something that the town would benefit the town right from day one if we do it. And that's why I like to see it looked at. And if you have numbers that work, great. Numbers that don't work, we'll come back at it later in the future. So it's something we should look at now, and I'd like to see that done.
Through Chair, I think I agree with the concept, but at town meeting, I specifically remember the discussion on the solar panels and the presentation that something would be looked at after the fact. And at town meeting, it was approved with the knowledge that the building was not going forward with solar panels, and that at a later date it would be looked at.
Well, I don't know if it's precisely like that, but it is a later date now, too, and it's not a bad idea to...
But I don't. I go back to my, if the town has approved something at town meeting, I don't see it as, if they want to do it and can do it within budget and it makes sense, that's fine, but I don't think we can do it as a condition because it was not part of the approval process.
It's not one of our site standards.
Right.
Our site plan standards.
But theoretically, I agree with
you. I mean, it's the roof holds more than 40 of these things, so wouldn't it?
I don't know the exact quantity that would fit up there. I'd have to look at the type of panel, but we have a renewable energy group that deals with this, so we can get some pricing.
Yeah.
I'll go ahead and talk to them.
Yeah, well, bottom line is the reason we take this process of doing the panels after the fact is I suspect is the same reason that your police station and your schools have it as a lease is because the private industry has more incentives. They're able to take advantage of the tax credits that you aren't able to take advantage of. So it's more advantageous to the town to lease out that roof space rather than put the panels up yourselves.
Okay.
It would be nice to have the numbers before we build it.
Well,
yeah, we can get that.
I mean,
we'll give you some.
I don't think that's our board, but I think you guys in just determining what you need to do. It's a reasonable suggestion to make sure it is. But
just a quick comment. I have 32 in my house, so I'm sure they'll have like a whole lot of
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So it. Okay, anything more on solar panels?
Thank you.
Public discussion. Anyone from the public have any comments on this one? Okay. Seeing none, board members. Okay, let's go through potential conditions of approval. Let's see. Let's start with the site or the letter from design review. We've already talked about the tube lighting. I don't think that has to be a condition. They're moving the stockade fence about emergency generator and add shrubbery. We'll figure that into a condition. What was the deal with mountain laurel? And is mountain laurel still shown on the plans?
No, I just didn't want it at the road. So
yeah, that's subject to salt spray.
Okay.
And so it's not
really very recommended.
Do you show it?
No.
Not shown on the plans.
But you're replacing that with some other screening.
We're taking it away from the road and moving it next to the building.
Yeah, the issue was it wasn't going to be salt tolerant, so you can move it and put something that'll hold up.
Yeah.
We've already talked about the diffuser, the gable louver to the salt shed.
Yep.
That's in the plans?
It's not right now. That's what we'll be adding based on what we hear from the design review board.
Let's put that as a condition. We have to approve the plans or a condition. We're not allowed to say submit it later.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, we've gotten ourselves nailed by our Board of Appeals. And in returning the colors, we'll let Design Review Board to deal with you guys on colors. Yes.
Question. This letter from Chief Slaman seems to indicate that all the fire department's questions are either answered or dealt with, but there were a couple things, like there was an issue about the proximity of the salt shed to something or other, that they wanted fire-resistant materials on the salt shed. So is that going to happen? Is that going to change the what the design review board saw? Is it going to change the look? Where does that stand?
Through Mr. Chairman, I had a discussion with the fire chief today, and he asked whether I believe that he should be here this evening.
Yeah.
And I said, based on the comments that were here, as long as he could send something that said that he was satisfied that there was no public safety issues, which
right,
he did,
right.
Mm-hmm. And that we would work through a lot of the comments, for example, available water for firefighting, sprinkler protection. That's a fire flow test that will occur in the final design phase.
Uh-huh.
So most of these things will be worked out with the fire chief. But as far as the building materials
are. You guys are waiting for Legacy Farms, basically they're canceling out, so you got an early evening.
Canceling out.
Well, they're going to have to resubmit because we're running out of board members. So sorry to interrupt you, John.
That's good, right?
I didn't want you to stick around.
Thank you.
Thanks. You'll get another notice in the mail and everything, so
it'll
be
over. Thank you. Sorry to interrupt.
No problem. Oh, I'm sorry. Jeez.
That's all right.
Yeah. So we will work with the fire chief to determine what the needs are there, and if they are fire resistant, if that changes the look of the building, then we'll certainly come back to design review.
And side note, did we discuss possibly other town vehicles using the undercarriage washer, like fire engines and police cars and stuff like that, or did you guys talk about that?
We didn't, but that facility is a town facility and certainly open to other town vehicles.
Okay. Let's see. We're through design review. I'm looking to see what other comments that we might need. Well, let's go through page 2. Beta letters, 3 remaining items, hazardous material management plans. Do we condition that, or is that just something that just happens?
I think that just happens.
I don't think we've ever conditioned something like that before.
I believe it's a requirement of the state fire code, so it's going to happen.
So it's going to happen from that aspect, regardless of what we do here tonight. Yeah. Okay.
The fire chief will issue a permit.
Got it. And no fire review and access and security. I think we're okay with that. Note to match the existing roadway section for repair on Wood Street. I think when you issue yourself a road opening permit, you will make sure that's covered.
Absolutely.
Let's see. So basically, we're looking for a waiver on the 50-foot buffer, vegetated buffer. And we've kind of talked about that. And then going through more site plan reviews, looking through the standards, everything complies except for the one waiver that I just talked about. And then we're talking about conditions, and they're on page 5. It's the site lighting that we talked about 1 hour after the closing of the building to the public. Event the snow on site exceeds the amount to be accommodated safely in the snow areas, you're going to have to move it. I think you might have the equipment to do that. And mechanical equipment will be screened. Then we'll add something about the fence around the DPW generator will be replaced by evergreen bushes. Dumpsters will not be emptied between 8, or only emptied between 8 and 5. Responsible for mitigating all construction-related impacts, including erosion, siltation, dust control in a timely manner. You'll remove your trash and debris, not bury it. And if Director of Municipal Inspections needs additional assistance, the town will pay for it. So those are the conditions, I think. Did we have a couple other ones that I missed?
I couldn't find anything in my notes that you had pointed out, but I don't know if anybody else had any.
Okay. Go ahead.
Discussion first.
Sure.
Before I actually say something.
Okay.
I don't want to sound picky, but I would just like to see it in black and white that we're going to have sand accessible to residents at this or other locations. If we're mentioning stuff like the dumpsters and construction-related impacts and things like that, why not put something in that we can say in black and white that, yeah, this is something we're thinking about, this is something we're aware about, this is something we care about.
Why don't we write quite a bit of narrative on our decisions, and we'll make sure that that's in the narrative portion and that the applicant has agreed to continue to provide that service somewhere. Would that satisfy it? And then we can leave it fairly broad like that. It'll be in the historic record and in the site decision. We could put a condition that says if it's not provided here, they will provide it elsewhere too.
I mean, well, I like how John said
we could end up doing that, but if you guys would feel better comfortable with that.
And ash disposal, those are the two services for the public that are not going to happen here.
So something along the lines of keep in mind that this is new construction. Some of the purposes and reasons for the.
I would just caution the board that you're stepping into maybe dictating policy, DPW policy to the DPW director and board of selectmen, and I would just caution you about that. I mean, if down the road something changes, 5 years from now, and the town decides they don't want to do it anymore, now you have a site plan condition that they're required to do it somewhere. So I would just be careful about that.
Well, this is something that's been communicated to me. What are we going to do about sand if we need sand? Well, I'm sure we're in good hands. But when I see stuff in here for conditions,
they all directly relate to your site plan standards.
Yeah, we don't have a standard that says that all site plans have to provide sand and ash disposal.
Well, the town services that are being taken away.
Well,
they're not being taken.
Three, Mr. Chairman, they're being relocated.
Well, they are.
And we wouldn't. Yeah. I have no interest in removing that service to the community. And if someone down the line did have that interest, it would have to go through, I'm sure, the Board of Selectmen before they just summarily decided not to provide that service anymore. So.
And my bringing up is not being taken as dictating policy. It's more we're the planning board, and part of our elected reason is to help plan things. And just like the library or anything else, if a board member gets approached by someone who has concerns, or we have concerns of our own, and we bring them up, this is the place to do it and discuss it. And if there's traction and consensus, and that's, we discuss things. So I hope no one takes it as I'm not dictating. But some of these, conditions, getting down to picky unit things, and I just don't want to miss something that's more important to people that don't come to our meetings, don't read the minutes, don't understand there's a change going on. They'll see it as, oh, we're not going to be able to get sand anymore, we're not going to be able to dump our ash anymore. What do we do about it? And why did the planning board let this happen? Without knowing the full story, and so if it's in black and white, well, here's a condition that we're acknowledging that this may change, but we're acknowledging that it's going to be taken care of. And we're not just ignoring that it's changing, that it will be taken care of, and this is part of the project.
We'll put some words in the decision.
Please, it sounds like it's being overly prescriptive on what they should or should be doing, and I disagree with that. I think let them make that decision. Now, if you want to make something frank in there that says the facility has to have the ability at some point to do something like that, that's different. But in terms of whether or not they do it, I think that's totally up to them. That's their decision to make.
Okay. Let's try this. On page 3, the first vote that the board will take is to grant a waiver from paragraph 210-121.1, which is buffers around non-residential uses in residential districts, not to require the 50-foot vegetated buffer along the western and southern border of lines. This waiver is justified by the fact that the project is in a previously disturbed area with dense wood areas unlikely to be disturbed immediately beyond the project site. So I'd look for a motion to grant that waiver.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. The next vote is to vote to determine that the plan complies with the site's plan standards with the following conditions. We'll put it into one vote. And the conditions are basically on page 5, which basically, condition 1 was the site plan lighting that we talked about. Second, the snow removal. The third one is mechanical equipment will be screened. The fourth one is a fence around the DPW will be replaced by evergreen bushes. The fifth one will be a gable end and will be installed in the salt shed roof for the design review portion. I think I'm up to six. Six would be dumpsters on the property would not be emptied unless they're between 8 and 5. 7 is mitigating all construction impacts. 8 is remove construction trash and debris, not burying it. And the last one is the director of municipal inspectors. If he needs some help, you're paying for it. So I look for a motion to find that it meets the site plans with those conditions. And to approve the site plan with those conditions. Yeah.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Second. Further discussion?
Discussion.
Sure.
I'd like to add 2 conditions. First condition is that as part of this project, that a barrel of sand be provided in front in a safe area so that citizens could have access to sand for emergency uses.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and second. Discussion.
The way I see it, it's part of the project and it should be included.
Is that offered today?
I know John will do the right thing, but if we don't put it in here in black and white, I feel better that it's in black and white in here. Now's the time to plan for it.
The problem is you're putting a bucket of sand without kind of engineering where you'd want it to be.
With all due respect, one bucket will be used in a heartbeat. Again, we go through a pile during a storm, so as I've stated, we're going to continue to provide that service at 1, maybe 2 locations. A couple have been mentioned. I'm just not comfortable that this is the site to have a bucket of sand, if you will.
Well, part of the problem was maybe people bringing trucks and filling them up and then scramming. And that's not right. So that's why you're putting the gate up. But a majority of people maybe don't do that and just take a bucket when they need it. That's not being...
Okay. I think we've had enough discussion. I think we're...
Can I just add to that? You know, what I'm hearing, the concern I'm hearing from Frank, and it's a concern I have as well, I've heard this from other people as well, you know, is this going to go away? Where's this going to happen? You know, is this going to happen because this is a service we use? And I take John at his word. I'm just concerned that this is something that could just kind of go away or get slip through the cracks if it's not articulated that this is an existing service that the residents want and expect to continue. If somebody decides to take that away, then that should be brought up and have a discussion, whether it's with the selectmen or whatever. But, you know, there are things like parking that we conditioned that had off-site, but we allowed that, you know, the off-site location is acceptable, but it's part of this plan. And this is a service that is part of the DPW facility that, you know, unless we want to just leave it open, that it might happen or it might not. Just a reference to the fact that whether it be provided on-site or off-site, that the facility shall accommodate this service. I'm afraid it's just going to too easily get forgotten.
Through the chair, I agree with the concept. I have a hesitancy, I think I share with Jennifer, of exactly what you said, it's a service. Permit questions are answered on the site. If I have a concern that permit questions have to continue at that site and can't be on another site, mm-hmm. is that something we write in? If it's a service provided by the town, we have town meeting, we have a board of selectmen. If a service goes away or is changed and we're unhappy with it, we have a public forum to do it. But I'm very hesitant when you have a service that is may have been done at the site but is unrelated to the site, writing that in to here.
I have a response for that. I was thinking about it. Say there's a car dealer across the street says, well, I'm going to provide sand to every customer, and he's in the same location, he has the same issues with the wetlands around him. The planning board is going to need to be aware of that, say the building, new building, whatever, and, oh, you're going to put a sand bucket there. All right, well, let's be knowledgeable about that. Let's acknowledge that and put in a condition that if you're going to put a sand barrel there, it shouldn't be so X, Y, and Z, and there's conditions with it.
But we're not, but if he wants to remove the sand barrel, we don't have the right to tell him he can't remove the sand barrel.
No, that's not what the condition is here, is that there's one made available in a place where the DPW director feels it's...
But that's unrelated to the site, so I have a concern.
Well, it's totally related to the site.
I have a concern where you're telling the town related to this site to do something someplace else. I think it's two different jurisdictions, and we have a mechanism within this town to handle it, as opposed to this mechanism.
I don't want to write that particular condition in, because number one, I think if you're going to have a pile of sand somewhere, you need to, I'm going to say, engineer it for it. I'm not sure that this location, you know, we spent a lot of money to keep the salt out of the wetlands around this area. It is in the area of watershed protection. And just to say that we're going to have a bucket or a pile of sand outside near the parking lot just, to me, doesn't seem like the responsible thing to do. I am not, if there are enough people, even if there was just the five members of this board that really wanted sand, we all know how to make such a stink with the Board of Selectmen that sand will continue. And, you know, you have a place to dump your ashes, too. That type of stuff will continue.
And I think it's something that's just happened over the years. You know, when I was chairman of the Board of Public Works, and you were on that board, yeah. I don't think there's a policy that exists that says that we're going to provide sand to the public. it just happened over the years. If you know,
it's appreciated.
It's appreciated.
I get my bucket list every three years.
It's also taken advantage of too.
Yep.
Right. So I think we're in a position now to put some controls on that.
Yep.
Right. And it's not a planning board condition that's going to do that. It's going to be the Board of Public Works or the Board of Selectmen that's going to do that.
No, Board of Public Works, but.
Okay.
Well, my the condition is
we have a condition before us. I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor
of, you're just voting on his condition.
Yeah, that's correct. Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
No. No.
Okay. So now you got another one.
Yes, and that we quotes are for solar panels being purchased are provided to us as well.
What do we do with quotes? We don't care what it costs. That's not one of the things that we can do.
I think on every town project that comes before us, I am concerned about the cost. And I would like to see solar panels be part of this project, but if it's doable. And if it's not doable right away, then it's something we can look at in the future and can compare the numbers from 2016 to, 2017 might be better, or a lease situation might be better, or a purchase. And we have to have the numbers as part of the planning in order to understand that.
I respectfully submit that we have no jurisdiction over that. But you made a motion, I believe. Is there a second? I see no second, so we're back to the original motion.
Thank you.
Okay. Is there, and so we, further discussion on the overall motion? Seeing none, you're ready for the vote. All those in favor of site plan approval with conditions, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Congratulations.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you
for your time,
your
consideration, your excellent input. Thank you.
And you're going to stick around and talk about sidewalks, please.
Going nowhere.
Are you guys in a rush to get this filed from us, or is it something that might wait a week or two?
We can wait. Okay,
I just didn't, you know. Where are you in your process of getting bids and stuff?
We are going before the Permanent Building Committee on Thursday evening. We're going to look at what our final design looks like, what our bid alternatives are. We're hoping to get this on the streets when, Jeff?
Like 2 months, basically.
So we're about 2 months out. We're looking at somewhere in August, late August, early September, to issue the award, raise the buildings, and have a ribbon cutting.
Okay, so you're going to try to get foundations in before winter.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Maybe steel up. You're going to be close.
Yeah.
But this helps us in that process. So.
Okay.
Again, thank you all very
much. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, why don't we take up, we got one more vote here that we got to make here, and then we'll do sidewalks. This one's really a quick one. Accept the formal withdrawal of the active site plan review for Legacy Farms special permit and the special permit amendment for the Northwest, Northeast and North Club Villages Legacy Farms, and also that'll be the first one, and then we'll talk about whether or not we give them a waiver or filing fees for the second time around. So let's first accept their formal withdrawal. Take a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
Discussion, please.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't understand the benefit to them to do this. If they don't withdraw it, and we have new members, and it's June, and we just take time to catch up with the new members of all of the...
If you haven't started the hearing from day one, you can't vote on it. So they would be down to maybe 6 votes.
Maybe
5. And quite frankly, they feel better having the full 9 members to vote on it so that one of us just doesn't say no and gives them a denial, you know.
There is no benefit to them to do this, believe me. They'd rather not do it.
Right. They're not happy campers, let me put it that way. But
it did seem like they were making the progress and changes that
they are making progress and they're whatever, but then, quite frankly, today they got scolded by Jennifer and myself in 2 different modes. They emailed us all the plan changes that they had promised us on the day of the meeting. And that is, I'm going to say, disrespectful to the board and our consultants, because how do you have a meaningful discussion right. when you haven't had any time to even digest them? So, you know. So, anyway, the motion in front of us is to withdraw.
Thank you.
Ready for a vote? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, then the next one is a respective waiver from any filing fees with a new submission. I think that's a reasonable request, given that it's actually board members that have gone down, you know, because of that. And I don't have a problem with that one.
I have a little bit of a problem because they're deciding to do this.
They almost didn't have any option with our 2 resignations. They really didn't.
But they didn't. I mean, because you weren't going to finish it. You have, they would have had tonight and May 9th, and there was no way you were going to finish that review in 2 meetings.
Right.
Unless you guys are superhuman.
And,
right, so it's nothing on their end,
yeah, right?
It's really us, so I don't see why.
Yeah.
It is not an unreasonable request.
Yeah. I don't have a problem with it.
Okay. Request a motion to waive any filing fees with the new resubmission.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, ready for a vote? Discussion?
One point, Mr. Chairman. Sure. Are we talking about a lot of money here?
I think so, but I'm not sure the exact number, but it's in the thousands. So... Yeah.
Well, the consulting fees, really.
Yeah, that's right. They're still
on the hook for the review fees.
Yeah.
I don't think it changes our...
Yeah, no, this is just like filing fees.
Yeah. I mean, I think we'd get so many per unit or something like that, and, you know, it's... That's
good that way.
I think we... Okay. So it's on the motion is on the table, I believe, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Can I just ask? Oh, go on.
Go ahead.
Just, so they've asked to be put on the, they're intending to file by the end of the week their new application.
We will put them on an agenda when we get confirmation from the selectmen when we're going to have all 9 members.
So to address that point, that's been advertised. Since April 12th, there have been no applications or interest to candidates, and so according to Elaine, they're not intending to schedule any meetings until they have interested candidates.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Oh, I know of 2 people that are interested in.
Then they need to get information to Elaine.
Okay. We'll make sure that happens tomorrow. So.
Okay. So let's say that all happens.
Then we'll talk about it agenda time.
Okay. So you don't want to talk about it right now?
No.
Okay.
Right. We got enough what-ifs going on. Okay. So let's talk about something that we all love to talk about.
Well, one more. You and I don't know if you saw it because it was an email late this afternoon from Roy about his master permit, special permit amendment. Wanted to know if we could get that done before the election.
Well, is that also, we got to continue that?
So, well, he didn't send a withdrawal, and And so we either have to continue it tonight to the next meeting if we think we can. You just sent an email, what did I do with it?
Yeah, I think I saw that one.
It just said, is it possible for us to...
Let's continue it to the next meeting. Quite frankly, I'm not sure we're going to have the information that would allow that to go.
Okay.
This is the adding the 180 units. Until we get his LNG safety plan, I'm not ready to vote for it.
Right.
I mean, you know, we're not going to add units to something if we don't have a mitigation plan.
Well, should I tell him that?
You could tell him that. Okay. I've told him that today,
too. Oh,
you
did? Okay.
I mean, it's you know, we're not going to add to the special permit area until we know we have an answer.
So
and they are working on an answer that might allow things to go ahead.
So is 151 Hamer only need a half an hour, do you think, on the night?
Yeah.
8:30 on May 9th, and the continuation.
Okay, so this is a special permit for the 180. It's a change to the master plan special permit to continue to 8:30 on May 9th. Entertain a motion.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion.
Yeah.
Point of order.
Yeah.
All right. So, can we just describe what happened? At 9 o'clock, we're supposed to meet about Legacy Farm North, and then they sent us a letter saying, okay, well, not enough members to vote on it, we're not going to get through it, and we just accepted that, they're going to refile, and we're not going to charge them, and we'll move forward on that. So, separately, the continued public hearing for the application to amend Legacy Farm's master plan special permit was supposed to be happening at 9 tonight, but maybe they assumed that we're just going to...
No, Roy sent me an email. That's what we just discussed.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, here it is. It's right in front of my face. It says, can we at least get our master plan special permit filing approved by the end of the planning board session so we don't have to file this again? I think that was his question. Like, can you just continue
it? So it's okay with him that he's not here.
Oh, he knew he wasn't coming.
Right. Yeah. Yep.
There was no question about that.
So the motion on the table, can we get your question answered?
Yes.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Okay, now we're talking about...
Actually, sorry, Mr. Chairman, is there anything you need to go further, or are you...
No, I think they're still looking for comments on a construction management plan for Legacy.
Yeah, I have a draft of that. We'll submit through the board.
Okay, you can continue to work on that, you know, as we're going along.
Very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
As far as I'm concerned, you can also continue to review the drawings that they just did today, too.
Fair enough. Have a good night.
Okay, thank you. Okay, to introduce sidewalks, we have a huge list of comments from public, which is kind of good.
Very good.
Somebody gets the word out, I guess. Mm-hmm.
And the survey is still open, right, John?
Yes.
So
there's no end date, really. Just whatever we feel
and
like.
Tell me at least a couple of months. That was a couple weeks ago.
So, John, where are you for this town meeting? Do you have an article for sidewalks or anything? Or
there is a placeholder for sidewalks.
In an article?
Yes.
Phase two.
Yeah. What has either capital improvements or anyone else, budget-wise, are they willing to put money there at this point?
We haven't had those discussions, Mr. Chairman.
I would recommend you wait a year, just because, and I love sidewalks, but putting something in on a budget item 2 weeks before town meeting is just asking for trouble. You know, we need more of a process. That's my opinion.
When we were, three, Mr. Chairman, when we were putting together our warrant article needs through the town manager's office and discussions with Elaine, we talked about putting in a placeholder so that if the community wanted to move something forward this year, whether it be the construction or design, that we had it there.
Mm-hmm.
Based on the numbers of folks, you've got 185 people that responded.
Yeah.
There is a there's an interest there, but, yep. but I agree. So I'm not the finance guy. Yep. I'll put the number in there, and we can have those discussions with capital improvement, and appropriations, and the Board of Selectmen, and it's up to them whether or not they wish to move it forward this year, and they've got to find where that funding comes from.
I would may take the mode of looking at the repair request and maybe go strongly forward with the repairs, because that, I think, you can justify under, you know, tripping and hazard type of thing. And, you know, I mean, obviously downtown, you're probably not going to do that because that's part of the whole big road improvement corridor thing. But, you know, repairs might be one that I would suggest you put on a priority.
We do have a budget item in our operating budget. It used to be only $4,000 per year.
Sure.
And I think that's why there are so many requests for repairs. Mm-hmm. But now it's $50,000 in addition to the $4,000. Okay. So we do have the funds to go out and to address.
Oh, okay. So those are not necessarily coming out of the same bucket.
Correct.
Okay. Then the other area where you can maybe make a lot of people more happy is if you look at the short sections in this area. And then I think this board would like to maybe contemplate the big sections. You know, that's the harder issue. But I mean, there's a lot of places where the sidewalk misses for one lot. The best example to me is Chestnut Street and Hayden Row,
yes. mm-hmm.
which is going to be right next to our dog park, which I got questions for at the Know Your Vote thing right before this, you know. And so, you know, it's one lot-ish worth of sidewalk. And it may be tough because there's a guardrail and stuff like that, but I know you know how to solve tough problems. And but, you know, there's areas where it's on a busy road with just a short section, you know.
That would also need funding, Mr. Yep. Chairman, so we'd have to bring that forward.
Yep.
One of the things that I was looking at, the sidewalks that we've built thus far have been, for lack of a better term, I'll call it easy, straightforward. There aren't mm-hmm. a lot of implications with wetlands, with grades. When we're looking at some of these other areas, certainly we get into areas of wetlands, of relocating guardrail to accommodate, of walls. So it might be worth it just to bring forward a plan of design.
Yep.
Because that construction number is going to be a wild card.
Yep.
To the okay. chair.
I'd like to recommend looking at the forgotten west side of town, especially along West Main Street, traveling along that, looking at the, and it's comment, lots of comments on there, along Lake Maspinock, the fishermen along the road, and I'm just afraid somebody's going to get it one of these days. Mm. And there is a lot of people who walk and jog that stretch, and there is no room for error at all. So it's an area that's heavily trafficked, that does get frequent walkers, joggers, and I think it would get more. And I look at these people who are fishing with their kids and walking along that stretch along the railings, and just at dusk, somebody's something's going to happen.
How many people walk in the wrong direction? That the cars behind them, they trust. Right. Wouldn't trust anybody these days with texting and stuff.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, that's one of those areas.
And that's
where
expensive.
It's expensive because the road is maximized, and then you've got the lake on either side.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
There's no room to put it between the guardrail and the fog line.
Right.
So that's one of those expensive ones. So if the board can put together a list of whether it's those short segments to make it continuous or new areas, I'm happy to bring forward a smaller number to town meeting. But I look towards the board, because you've done an excellent job of getting the word out there, and people have responded.
Mm-hmm. Could you look at these that have been identified here as almost ranking them 1, 2, or 3, right? So 3 being very difficult, 1 being very easy, and does that help prioritize some things? See, if you heard feedback from the public, they clearly identified these really the top 5. Everything else is onesies, twosies.
Mm-hmm.
And even within that context, right, the Chestnut to Ash one, right, coming off of 85. Mm-hmm. I would say that's kind of easy, right? There's plenty of shoulder right now, right? Mm-hmm. You're just going essentially up and hill and down to Ash. Now, I think if you were to kind of make Ash, if you take that left on Ash, then it gets tricky because you don't have much shoulder. You're dealing with, you know,
scenic road.
Scenic road, or, you know, it's not wetland per se. Some of it may be wetlands are protected. Then it gets a little bit trickier, more expensive.
Mm-hmm. Am I allowed to?
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't know the Woodville section of town that I live in, but the route along Spring Street, Fruit Street, the Framingham that everybody takes, that a lot of people walk on, there's nothing there. So I know that's far out, but maybe, you know, from Woodville, maybe start reaching something like that.
You know, it might be nice to get Woodville connected, you know, like in front of the church to connect to the brand new approved sidewalk in front of the DPW building would be another short section.
So that's we looked at that. It's 1.2 miles to go from where it ends at the church to Woodville. And I think that's an excellent one because it brings in Reed Park, it gets folks out towards to Woodville, gets folks out towards the new facility that's going to be built on Fruit Street. So there's a lot of
benefit there. About that, and I honestly don't think people would use that. You have the whole group out Woodville that stays out there, but who's going to really walk from Woodville? You know what I mean? I think there's a lot of better opportunities where I see, like Ken's point, I see people walking all the time. Right? I think it was your point. Walking all the time. When you see people walking all the time, you're worried about them getting hit.
Yeah. It's.
But, by the way, you're not going to do anything with this election, it sounds like?
For
town meeting? Sorry?
Well, I don't know. I don't.
I was just going to say that for the next one, when I got into the planning board, if you need somebody to lead, sidewalks are my passion. So.
Oh, okay.
Get involved in that. I love it.
That's nice.
John knows that. I emailed John.
Tell you, you know, sidewalks, we got such positive responses on what we did, which is really great. Yeah. You have any money left over from that last pit? Are you doing to Clinton Street?
We're doing to Clinton Street, and we're going to use the full remaining amount, which is just under $700,000.
So that's the last piece that you got money really for?
Yes.
Okay.
And in my 30 years of public works, the sidewalks here have been the most praised and well-received projects that I've ever been involved with. So
just further comments, sorry to interrupt, but the sidewalks, you guys have been doing it great. The sidewalks Legacy Farm did to come to town. Why are they street level? That's silly. Sidewalks should be curb level. You know, like you raised them, like whatever it is to the berm. I mean,
we did some got raised, but most of them didn't.
We had a discussion. The developer looked at the condition of approval, and we provided him with the specifications, the same construction specifications. And where there was a separation of, I think we called it 18 inches, we didn't require him to put in a berm.
I think that's what Elaine said to him, but in the bylaws, right? So I was going to chalk that down one these days.
So where there was no separation, he either put in a berm or he still owes us a berm in one small section. but that's why.
And the area going from Legacy Farms Road to the athletic parcel is slated to get sidewalk this summer from Mr. McDowell. Yeah. Most of that will be bermed on
is that Legacy South or North?
Legacy North.
When are they going to put the curbs in Legacy South on the main road?
There are no curbs.
They're not going to be?
No.
That's ridiculous.
Well, that is.
I can see within those streets of the little village, but the main one down?
What is that? Sustainable. Stormwater control.
Low
impact development. Country drainage, yes.
The north is about, it's the same as well.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Question?
Yes.
There's $54,000 a year for repairing, and then there's these sidewalk projects are additional money. If we just got this today, so I mean, you've seen this too, or?
Just saw it today, myself.
Yes, so I guess we need to digest and think about different ideas.
I think if you went in with millions of dollars 2 weeks before town meeting, that would be career limiting. That's personally. I mean, you know, I just don't think, you know.
That's why I would look for a recommendation.
It's a limit there.
Yeah. Well, we do not want to, we like you enough that we don't want to send you to slaughter.
Thank you.
But, you know, maybe some engineering money to get it started, you can kind of justify that. Mm. I mean.
And so Elaine also wanted some long-term thinking, too, about from the master plan section for sidewalks. So, I mean, that could tie into John doing something next year if we put some long-range stuff together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know what we could do? We could tie up maybe some of the planning board might have a little bit of engineering money left to this year. Maybe we could hire a consultant to kind of map all this stuff for us, or something like that.
We've got a map of the existing sidewalks.
Oh, okay.
As part of our plan last year, we did an analysis of existing networks.
Okay.
So I can share that.
So you know where all the gaps are?
Yes.
Oh, so.
That actually is going to be a good plan to have. We can mark it up even.
Mm-hmm. I'll share that with you, Jim.
Yeah. That'd be great. Yeah.
So I want to say, John, you do a really good job, and with all respect to the DPW has before you, you've been the best that I've seen.
So, thank you very much.
When I ask questions or bring up ideas, it's not meant as criticism of you or anything you're doing. Just additional viewpoints that I want to bring, and I totally respect the work you're doing and appreciate that you're here. And
thank you.
If you leave, then I'm scared. So
okay, let's get on with other things other than sidewalks so we get out of here at 10. Thank you, John.
Thank you all very much.
Okay.
And again, thank you for your consideration and approval of our site plan.
Good luck with everything.
Thank you very much.
Okay, the next item we bring up is the board to consider voting to recommend town meeting article 42. 42 is the easement at Cumberland Farms to allow our lane to get done. It is morphed into a fairly small easement. Really, we're starting at the eastern side of the Cumberland Farms driveway, but it's a 10 by 12 or 10 by 15 foot area. Elaine, I think, told me, or Jennifer did, somebody today, is Cumberland Farms is okay with that. They're encumbered by another easement over that, so they can't do anything with it. So it's maybe a car length shorter than what I was kind of hoping to see, but I think we can work with that. And we're not messing with their driveway, too. Mm-hmm. And for a car, it might be the easier thing to do.
Sounds like it.
And so anyway, that's... This will, if we go forward at a town meeting, we'll get something done first, and if it ain't long enough, we'll worry about that
down the road.
So, look for a motion to recommend town meeting warrant article 42.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries unanimously. Okay, we've already talked about sidewalks. Master plan update. Fran and Frank, I think you're the only section outstanding.
Nice. I sent a friend, at the beginning of this meeting, I emailed Fran a general update that needs some wordsmithing, but I think we're close. So,
say May 9th.
Okay. How much time do we have on May 9th left? Did we screw that all up?
No, because we have 7:30 Ash Street, we have 8 o'clock 151 Hayden Row, and we have 8:30 that we just did the master plan special permit. So if that doesn't happen.
Let's not schedule anything other than the master plan for the rest of that meeting.
Okay.
And we'll, this will not be the public hearing, but this will be go for the three sections that we have not. As a board reviewed.
Okay, so.
So.
You want me to provide everybody with copies of
yes.
what's been done so today?
In fact, maybe the whole damn thing.
Okay.
Because you want to read it in context, and we need it more than. As soon as these two guys get their section done.
Yep.
Yeah, Claire?
Mr. Chair, if we don't get it in on May 9th, I do want to make sure that the board does revisit with the Cultural Arts Alliance the plan, and it doesn't fall by the wayside.
The landscaping?
They have not done the landscaping.
Correct. I have a note. I've talked to a couple people. They were waiting for planting season. They are aware they have to do it.
Okay.
But I do have a note on my desk to follow up with them in like a month or so.
All right. Okay.
Okay. So we're going to do the master plan. Let's see. We'll find out from the selectmen when the appointment meeting might be ready to do it. I got phone calls from a neighbor to the library project who was very concerned that nobody had staked out the corner lots and lot corners, mm-hmm. and he was a little afraid that they were site prepping across the line a little bit, but without it being staked out, obviously it's kind of hard to tell where it is. The problem that I think he was frustrated with more than others is that nobody in town hall answered his question. The building committee didn't do anything. The town manager didn't do anything. Elaine didn't do anything. I mean, that's the more frustration to it. Quite frankly, I went over and looked at it from the fence, you know, 100-something feet away. I didn't see where there was anything, you know, it's not like somebody took a bulldozer through the middle of the guy's backyard or anything that. And there was, I'm not sure whether the garage in that one building was actually located on the other guy's lot at one point. Mm-hmm. You know, so if anything, I think it was back in that corner, but it didn't look like significant things were going that down. But he was concerned that they hadn't surveyed it. Now, nothing is surveyed on that whole block, I think, for a while.
There was a survey done at the, when I was on the PBC, and there is actually a shortage. The designated distance of that block is actually shorter. It is on the plans longer than the block is.
Right, 3 feet or
by
something.
By 3 feet.
Yep.
And so I'm sure there's issues of exactly where the lot lines are.
And but I think they resolved that by taking it out of the library's parcel.
Did.
So the library got sure.
Right.
How that happens, because my lot got surveyed when I bought the land next to me, it's you take the parcel, and then each piece that gets subdivided in order gets placed down there. And then if you're the last guy standing, you get what's left. You know, and I mean, if you think you're getting 200 feet and you get 187 feet, that's only what's left. You know, something screwed up in the last 300 years. And you know, you are. And so I think maybe that lot got subdivided from Church Place the other way. Or either that or the surveyor didn't want to fight with the guys and took it on the town's side. But
the road widened, or?
You just never know. But the question is, I don't think there's a stake out there that says where that is. Maybe it's because the stake was probably might have been in the garage. I don't know. But
so,
anyway.
So at the end, there really is no answer for this abutter from anybody in the town.
Well, the right thing to do is to go put up iron pipe where the damn lot is.
And who would do that? The building inspector?
No, you have to hire a surveyor, and the surveyor that found that discrepancy is the best one because he's done all the research, and he would know where to go measure from and go put it in.
So I'm just wondering who would initiate that. I mean, here you've got somebody who...
Well, the permanent building committee is the ones that are in charge of the project. So, you know, that's something they've got to do. You know, maybe what we need to do is include in our rules and regulations in the past that all new site plan reviews have surveyed with lot corners in place. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's so many pieces of property that don't have anything marked, and I always found knowing where your land is and your neighbor's land is makes for better neighbors. And you might not have to mow so much. Let's see. That's That's all I've got, I think. Any other comments?
I have one other item, just because Claire reminded me. Davenport. Must be coming up to C of O's issuing, and those signs are still not changed on the stone walls. And yeah, so since they have a history of doing things without permission and then asking for forgiveness.
So fortunately, they're going to be coming back to you because they want to change their landscaping plan. And so Chuck Joseph was in my office today about that. So when I go back to him with that, I will mention that Ken and I already spoke about it. I will mention the sign. When they come before you, you're more than welcome to mention the sign. But I will definitely bring it up to him because I noticed that the other day too.
Yeah.
I thought of Claire when I heard that they were coming back in.
Burn the candle for me, guys, because it was one of my points. So keep on it.
Yeah.
I just wanted, is there a need for us to meet before town meeting? Because they booked a room for us. But
I think you want to post it just in case.
We have a room already, but I just didn't know if we need to post an agenda.
If the agenda would be simple to discuss any town meeting articles for that.
What time?
Let's say half an hour before town meeting, so it'd be 6:30.
Okay.
And at this point, we've made recommendations on all of our articles, so I don't think we're going to need it. But in case something happens to pull something, and we can always cancel it. And that would be my preference to... inclination is it's going to be canceled.
Okay.
And it's May 2nd?
Yes.
It's Monday.
Which is Monday, which is coming up pretty quick, isn't it?
One week.
Oh, he's going to go ask for money at 1 week? Oh, he'd get slaughtered. He'd get slaughtered. Yeah. Anyway. I think we got everything taken care of. Anyone else got anything else? Looking for a motion to adjourn? Second. Okay, I think I heard a motion to adjourn in a second. Okay. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.